Dear friends and colleagues, when I first saw that some of you are interested to celebrate my achievements as head of clinical biochemistry at UHN, I almost immediately decided to decline. I do not need any celebration whatsoever because I simply did my job and I got paid very well for it. However, on second thought, I appreciated the willingness of some people to honor me, and I thought I would be unkind, even rude, to decline. So this is why I'm here. I do not know who these people are, but I thank them for their generosity. For those who know me well, they will expect no less than a pompous, egotistical, and megalomaniac presentation. Vintage diamantes. If I were not like this, it wouldn't be me. However, I will also try and tell you my personal story and associate it with what happened to laboratory medicine over the last 40 years in Toronto for those who do not know the story. So, here we go. If I'm not politically correct during the entire presentation, I apologize ahead of time. By the way, if you like the video, my creative student, Kaitlyn DiPaolo, did everything. If you do not like it, it is all my fault. The first person to play a major role in my career was Dr. David M. Goldberg, ex-chief of clinical biochemistry at the University of Toronto and SickKids, who found my first job in Toronto in 1986. At a small spin-off company of the Hospital for Sick Children called Cyberfluor Inc. As Director of Research and Development, I was responsible for developing an analytical system for ultrasensitive immunological assays. I believe that I did a good job, but what I did not know was that somebody was watching me. After 2 years of tenure, one day, I had a visit from my second mentor, Dr. Andrew Baines, who was the chair of clinical biochemistry at that time. He came to Cyberfluor and expressed interest in making me his deputy at the university, as well as he told me that the Toronto General Hospital was getting ready for a hostile acquisition of a smaller hospital called Toronto Western Hospital, and he wanted somebody to run the labs. I accepted, but under the condition that I would have space and other resources for doing good research. Dr. Baines assured me that he did not want to hire me to run his glucoses, but he wanted academic achievements. I was very lucky to join a fantastic group of about 30 technical staff, all of them very young, with whom I had a lot of fun running the labs as well as engaging in extracurricular activities, including playing tennis at lunchtime, going to dinners, etc. This was the best technical team I ever worked with at the Toronto Western, but our destiny had it that they were split after 6 years in 1994. That brings me to the next milestone of my career. In 1994, there was great appetite for public-private joint ventures, one of them being the famous Toronto Medical Laboratories, the laboratory that serviced the newly named the Toronto Hospital and included Life Labs. This humongous laboratory was located at the Missionary Institute. Then the leadership came up with the idea of closing the labs at the Toronto Western and operating only a small stat lab. I realized then that my job was in danger, but I didn't wait long before to make my new move. One day, out of the blue, I had a visit from Dr. Kenneth Prisker, the visionary pathologist in chief at Mount Sinai Hospital, who came to the Western and told me that he monitored my scientific output and wanted me to become his new head of clinical biochemistry at Mount Sinai Hospital. I accepted the proposition under the provision that he would provide me with excellent research space and ample resources to continue my research. He told me the same thing as Dr. Baines. I do not want you to run my glucoses. I have other people to do this. Then I asked, what did he wanted me to do? He said, make my department internationally renowned in laboratory medicine. And this is exactly what I was set to do. Working at Mount Sinai Hospital between 1995 and for the next 10 years, my research lab named ACDC lab, meaning maybe Advanced Center for the Detection of Cancer, expanded to about 30 people. We even had our own merchandise, from t-shirts to laser pointers, etc. We published a lot during that period, and we had an abundance of talent, including people that you know, such as George Youssef, Vathany, and many others. In short, our scientific and academic output continued to grow and grow and grow. Being at Mount Sinai Hospital, I had an office adjacent to Dr. Sylvia Aza, a brilliant pathologist with whom I chatted every day. One day, Sylvia told me that she accepted the position of pathologist in chief at the Toronto Hospital and that she had in mind some major changes. When I asked what kind of changes, she said that they are dismantling the Toronto Medical Laboratories and dissolving the relationship with Life Labs, at that time represented by Brad Davids, and taking back the testing.
3, 2, 1.
She also told me that her grand plan was to merge the departments at the downtown hospitals within a single laboratory serving all of them. When I asked where this laboratory would be located, she said that it would be at the University Avenue and Gerard Corner. When I noted that this was a street intersection with traffic lights, she asked me not to worry too much, because her plan was to use Tomahawk and cruise missiles to shoot samples underground from one place to another. Thus solving the problem. At that time, Brad Davids became the administrative leader of the now known University Health Network. Brad gave me a nickname, the Bismarck, after the famous German battleship, for a reason I never understood. But it was reminiscent to me of The Rock, the famous wrestler turned actor Dwayne Johnson. Then Sylvia had the bright idea to appoint me biochemistry chief at both hospitals, UHN and MSH, so that this facilitates the merger and the collaboration between UHN and MSH. I accepted the position and became joint chief, but as you all know, there is and likely will never be such thing as a UHN-MSH collaboration because the two institutions are competitive and they never really wanted to collaborate. Nevertheless, with a beautiful laboratory at 60 Murray Street and lots of resources from Prisker, Aza, and Davis, we flourished. And we continue publishing and publishing and publishing and graduating students along with the provision of clinical service and education. I also acknowledge the UHN leadership's successes, although the times I reminisce were different. Thanks to Ranjan Chetty, Catherine Tinkham, and Catherine Wang, who, in the face of financial difficulties, and very understandably, managed to modify my unique agreements with the previous leaders without causing much harm to my research. One unexpected happening of my reappointment at UHN was my reunification with my youthful Toronto Western Technical staff, which was transferred to TGH. But it was painful to watch. After almost 20 years, my youthful team became seniors with canes, maladies, and other pains. But the most painful of all was seeing them being treated as second-class citizens, aliens who came from nowhere to claim the jobs of the much older incumbent technical staff at TGH. As you may know, KPMG is a world-class giant consulting company, and they brought them in the 2000s to help us merge the laboratories. After spending thousands of hours and millions of dollars, nothing came out. But I came up with something. I requested and given a visor signed by Phil Mickelson, the famous golfer who is a KPMG spokesperson. My professional success can be measured by independent indicators, and based on this, I believe that I have the numbers to claim a triumph. Modesty, eh? With over 900 PubMed index papers, over 63,000 lifetime citations, H index of 125. You will wonder, what the heck is an H index? It stands for humbleness index. I'm joking. And graduation of over 50 PhDs and 25 master's students, I believe that the yield was very good, even if expensive. This could have never been done without the unqualified support of my visionary leaders that I already mentioned. I am grateful to them. I also won during this period just about every award in laboratory medicine from the Department of Laboratory Medicine, the Faculty of Medicine, the whole University of Toronto, the Ontario Society, the Canadian Society, the American Society, and many other international societies. I now have a problem where to put all these awards that span from education to research to clinical care. My wife doesn't want them, my kids do not want them, and my grandkids are asking, Grandpa, what is this rectangular wooden frame with some writing in it? I say, you can have it, but they are smart to decline. To be very honest with you, I wouldn't have declared success without looking at what happened to my family, which, when I arrived in Toronto, my daughter was 5 and my son was 4. I am proud to say that my daughter is now a clinical chemist at Unity Health and a talented musician. Who cares about clinical biochemistry? My son, as many of you know, he's a neuropathologist at University Health Network, but he's a lousy tennis player, unfortunately. Also, our son-in-law is staff physician at UHN, as well as our daughter-in-law is a neurosurgeon in training. I am married to Anastasia Diamandis for close to 50 years, and I was lucky to find her when I was a student at the University of Athens. To get an idea as to who she is, this joke tells all. A fellow friend, Dr. James Wu, who used to work at Arup Laboratories, took me for a lecturing tour in Taiwan 20 years ago and used to introduce me as a very famous and very smart man. And after all this, he would whisper in the microphone, "He is smart, but his wife is smarter." I always welcome this gesture because it is true, and I appreciate all the support and advice that my wife gave me. She kept me out of trouble on many occasions. Despite claiming that I succeeded in my profession, life is not about the job, but it's about a lot of things. The most important, in my opinion, being our families. When I came to Toronto, it was me, my wife, and my two kids. Now we have three lovely granddaughters and two lovely grandsons with whom we derive a lot of pleasure. To be honest, the best time of my current life is when I sit 3 to 4 meters away and watching without talking my wife playing and teaching these young children various things, including the Greek language. I close this presentation hoping that I did not bore you too much and hoping that you learned some of the history of laboratory medicine in Toronto over the last 40 years. If I were to give an advice to the younger generation, I would say, life is not just a profession and the clock is ticking. I thank again the myriad of people who helped my career, especially Antoninus Susaipilai, the most amazing employee I ever had. My mentors, graduate students, postdocs, technical staff, administrative staff, undergraduate students, summer students who participated in this journey. I hope that the journey will continue a little bit more since we still have a few things to contribute, I believe. And one of my mottos that I want you to remember if you wish. When I was young, my intention was to use my team to succeed. And now, at 68, my intention is to use my success to help my team members succeed. Thank you very much for your attention.